Hello, everyone. So my name is Andrew Brown, and I'm going to be conducting an interview with Dane Dormio about this cool thing called martial energetics. And let me just read a quick passage from his student workbook. Martial energetics is a transformative, holistic mind-body discipline that combines principles from internal martial arts and other traditional mind-body modalities with insights from physics, neurology, and other modern-day sciences to actualize human potential, cultivate health and well-being, and heighten spiritual awareness. Now, that's a lot. That's a lot of different things. So,
it's actually as concise as I could make it considered. It's boiled down as, like Einstein said, things should be made as simple as possible and no simpler.
I agree with that. So, martial energetics is a martial arts system. So what qualifies a group of skills and practices to become a system that you would teach to other people? Like, what made that transformation in your head? They go like, oh, this isn't just a bunch of things I've practiced and studied and I think I understand, to like, I can teach this as like, okay, we can go through step by step and I can take someone from zero to hero in X amount of years.
That's a really great question. And I'm feeling two different directions, possible directions to go with it. But I just want to clarify that you're asking what qualifies or defines something as a system.
In your words, yeah.
Yeah.
You don't have to go too deep.
Well, it actually is a pretty deep question, and the thing that comes to mind for me as a mathematician actually is Gödel's theorem.
Okay.
And you might know about Gödel's theorem. I'm guessing a lot of our listeners might not, but it's a very famous theorem in mathematics and formal logic from the early part of the last century that says that any formal logic system cannot be both complete and consistent. It can be one or the other, but not both. And an intuitive kind of formulation of this is, if you have a formal logic system, like say a language, and I use the example of a language because it's a familiar example, I think, and it extends by analogy to other things. Well, if you have a language that's 100% internally logically consistent, then there will be certain things that language cannot describe, so it won't be complete. On the other hand, if you have a language that can describe everything there is to describe, i.e. a language that is complete, then it cannot be 100% completely internally logically consistent. It will inherently have some internal inconsistency. So Gödel, it was a really astounding paradigm shift in mathematics, actually pretty comparable to the shift from classical physics to quantum physics, the sort of intellectual philosophical shift. This and the shift from the, and there are similar exclusion kind of principles, like the Heisenberg uncertainty principle, which deals with position and velocity, or time and energy. So both of these things can't both be precisely known at the same time. And it also comes up in the aspect experiment, which was an experiment designed to test the EPR paradox. The EPR paradox was named after Einstein and some other guys who said the universe has to be local and causal, because that's what conforms to our intuition. And they actually designed this thought experiment, the EPR paradox, to test, to confirm their belief, their postulate that the universe is both local and causal. And when the experiment was actually done several decades later, when technology advanced to the point where the experiment could be done, the results of the experiment didn't conform with Einstein's hypothesis, and it turns out that the universe, you get to either have a local universe or a causal universe. You can take your pick, but the universe cannot be both local and causal. Experiments have confirmed. Mm.
All right, so your system is neither local or causal.
Well, these are just analogies to compare to the idea of complete and consistent.
Yes. Okay.
So, for purposes of Marshall energetics, to answer your question, what qualifies something as a system? It's actually something that we'd like to be both as complete and consistent as possible.
I agree. Gotta look
within the minimum necessary bounds. So, Gödel has showed us that no logical system can be both 100% complete and 100% consistent, but we can at least aim towards 100%, at least aim towards that as an ideal and being as complete and consistent as possible. And so Marshall Energetics is a framework that I have unearthed and outlined and fleshed out over the years that is an attempt to unify all of martial arts, similar to unification in physics or other sciences.
Yeah.
Where
that's a great goal. Unify all of martial arts.
That's the idea. It's a framework within which everything in martial arts can be dealt with.
I get you. Okay.
And over the years, as I've been exposed to many things, when I get exposed to something new, since I first unearthed and clarified this framework, everything new, I try to fit it in there, and if it doesn't fit, then I sort of expand the parameters of the system so that it does fit, so that it is included.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. And eventually it got to a point where it seemed to be stable, where new concepts or phenomena in martial arts would come in and be accounted for, but they would be able to, it would be possible to do that within the existing framework of the system without having to shift or adjust anything. So as far as I've seen at this point, it's a complete system. If something comes along that is totally new and needs to be incorporated into the model, that will actually be great, because that means it can become more
better. Yeah.
and complete. But at this point, it seems to be as complete as I can really conceive of it being.
All right. Well, let me go over the primary influences and secondary. So you list Tai Chi Chuan and Kung Fu Sansu, and we talked about your experience with those styles in the previous podcast. And then secondary influences, you go through Wing Chun, Bak Fu Pai, Capoeira, Contact Improv, Parkour, Taekwondo, Aikido, Jiu-Jitsu, Sistema, Yoga, and Psycho-Cybernetics. This is a lot of stuff. You're saying, well, I've incorporated all these ideas within your system, and you say, well, I can explain at least most of yoga using martial energetics principles, and you can explain Bak Fu Pai using martial energetics principles, and you can explain Tai Chi Chuan using Fortune Jack's Pistol instead of having to go to the original Tai Chi Chuan texts and the Bok Fu Pai texts and start pulling ideas from there. You say, well, I've already incorporated those ideas into my system, so I can explain all of the techniques and the aspects and the skills of Tai Chi Chuan to you through martial energetics, instead of saying, oh, we're going to go study Tai Chi Chuan. No, we're going to study martial energetics, and you're going to learn what you need to know about Tai Chi Chuan. That's basically what you're going for.
That's a really great way to put it that I actually hadn't thought of it that way, but explicitly, but that is a really great way to put it. And since this is a system that is as complete and consistent as possible for treating all subjects and phenomena in martial arts, yes, you could explain or model all of these systems in martial energetics. You could perform them or explain them using the principles of martial energetics. That's a really great way to look at it. And based on what I was saying before about being as complete and consistent as possible, I think anything that I've seen so far in martial arts can be couched in terms of martial energetics principles. It's sort of like Newton inventing calculus, and then every problem in physics can now be formulated in terms of calculus instead of in terms of geometry, which was the approach that the only approach there was from the time of Euclid until Newton. Everybody was working with basically geometry, algebra, and arithmetic, and then Newton came along and invented calculus, and now all of these problems could be dealt with in terms of that framework. So it goes both ways. That's kind of the reverse of how I normally think about it, but yes, it does go both ways, and that's a really great way to look at it.
Cool.
The way that I when I say those things are influences, those are all systems that I've studied in some depth. Any one of those systems independently, I could sort of present to someone, and there are elements of all of those that are recognizable in martial energetics, such that somebody who was only familiar with one of those things, like somebody who is only familiar with Aikido, would look at some things in martial energetics that would be recognizable. And somebody obviously who's just familiar with Tai Chi would see a lot in martial energetics who would recognize. Likewise, for who's only familiar with Sansu or Taekwondo or Capoeira, etc., would look in martial energetics and see things that they recognize. But as well, you could look at it as martial energetics being a vehicle through which you could access the core principles of any, you could approach the core principles of any one of those if you wanted to.
Cool. Okay. So one of the things we have in martial energetics is health and longevity. So just like the Taoists, they say we study martial arts for self-defense, but also to make our lives beautiful and long. So you list out a lot of things here, but basically, if you want to be healthy, you do your calisthenics, you keep your body, you keep your muscles trained, you keep your lungs trained, you make sure you're capable, and then you do your Qigong, and then after that, so that's your personal health. And then you start dealing with your self-defense. That's what it looks like. You teach the self, and then you teach how to deal with the other. Is that how you kind of lay it out?
Yeah, you could look at those as different layers. they're not necessarily linear. They have to be presented in some kind of linear fashion, obviously. But it's a body material that could be approached from any direction. But for kind of general purposes, that's how I like to present it as kind of the foundational layer being personal wellness and fitness, and then building building directed skills, focused skills and qualities on top of that. Because that's the foundation that could that you could build in on in any direction you wanted. Even if martial arts isn't your thing, you could build on a foundation of wellness and fitness to excel in whatever area you choose.
Yeah, every athlete has pretty good balance, pretty good range of motion. They do everything they need to do pretty well. If they can't do it, they're not going to be a good athlete.
Right. In terms of physicality, in terms of mentality, intellect, psychological, emotional health. If you want to be a high performing individual in kind of in any area of life, whether you're going very deep with meditation, or you are achieving things in the entrepreneurial world, or you you know, whatever area of life a person wants to pursue optimal well-being, performance, and optimal existence, this is a foundation that provides for all of that.
All right. And the way we get there is we have some foundational principles just laid out. So let's go through them. So NEP, the non-exertion principle. Why don't you just tell me about NEP?
Okay, yeah, the non-exertion principle says don't try too hard.
Okay.
That's the most concise version of it. It can be expanded in quite a bit of detail, but essentially in everything in martial energetics, everything in Qigong, Qigong is a foundation. All martial energetics is a form of Qigong in the way that that internal martial arts and in the great tradition of internal martial arts, it's a form of Qigong. And so everything in martial energetics, we're not trying too hard. We're exercising soft intent. We have an intent or an intention, but we are not trying too hard. We're not becoming too fixed, too rigid on how we achieve that intention. And we're not overexerting in any of the many ways there are to do that. We are working within our body's capacity to gently expand it from within. So the non-exertion principle, don't try too hard, sometimes referred to as a 70% rule, as in 70% of your capacity is kind of a benchmark for where to work.
Yeah.
So the non-exertion principle applies to Qigong, but it's also a very fundamental Taoist principle.
Yes, yes. The way I interpret it is, if you commit to 100% before you can get to 70%, you could easily miss the target. And so my old martial arts teacher, they always said 50%. You say 70%, but the whole idea was don't throw your punch 100% and like just go for the kill shot when you don't even, you haven't even set up like your distance. Because if you don't, if you're going to throw 100% kill shot and then you miss, well, you just exposed yourself in the worst possible way. And now your opponent has a lot of advantage on you because you messed up and you've thrown everything you had into this one point and you missed. And now something's coming right at your face. So what do you do? And so that 70% rule, very good to set up all of your martial arts strategy and also for your life. Yeah. If you just spend 100% of your time programming, you're never going to live a life. You're just going to be a programmer. And I've met guys like that. You don't want to be a person like that.
There's so lots of ways that things can go wrong when you try too hard.
Yes. I like that. All right. So let's move on. So the PP is the pleasure principle. Now that one, it's not listed right away. So why don't you just go over it? So I don't have any detail on it in front of me.
The pleasure principle says that it's also a foundational principle of Qigong. and Taoist philosophy in life, if you wish, says that if it feels good, that means you're doing it right. If it doesn't feel good, that means you're doing it wrong. So with Qigong, generally, it's never about enduring, pushing through pain, toughing it out, using willpower. If it is, it just means you're not doing it correctly. If you're doing it correctly, then it's something that is innately pleasurable and is something that you're positively motivated to do. So it essentially takes no willpower to continue the practice. It might take some willpower to overcome some pre-existing habits or inertia, but when you start to practice, if you're practicing right, it'll feel good and you'll want to practice more and it'll feel better, and so you want to practice more. So I think this is particularly important too. There's kind of pitfalls associated with this, like there are with the non-exertion principle, pitfalls associated with trying too hard. There's pitfalls associated with
gluttony.
Practicing Qigong in a way that doesn't feel good, that is uncomfortable, or that is even painful. And then thinking, oh, that's what Qigong is or feels like, I don't like that, and then dropping out, giving up on your practice because you think it's something that doesn't feel good.
Yeah, I can't tell you how many of my just basic Tai Chi students say, oh, meditation is one of the hardest things in the world. How do you even do it? And I keep telling them, it's the easiest thing in the world. You don't have to do anything.
But well, that is a very hard thing for many people, doing nothing.
that stops them from doing it when it's like super easy, and they could do it right now, and they just don't know that it's so easy to do.
In my experience, the greatest challenges for people learning Tai Chi are being still and doing nothing and relaxing. It's very challenging. It's the biggest obstacle for many people.
Yeah. We humans, we don't stop. We just go. So, yeah, we have to stop and take, you know, smell the roses once in a while. That's what Tai Chi teaches you. All right, let's move on. So we have this thing called the three regulations. Now that is broken out into mind regulation, breath regulation, and body regulation. I guess not necessarily in that order, but how would you explain the three regulations to a new student?
Well, the order isn't too important, but
yes.
See, I do like to, assuming I'm starting with a kind of idealized student from a blank slate, somebody who shows up and says, I have no experience, I'm ready to learn.
Empty cup.
Exactly, the idealized kind of empty cup. I like to present mind regulation and then body regulation and then breath regulation, because the mind regulation is the mind paying attention to itself, which is also known as meditation or mindfulness.
Yeah.
And from expanding on that basis of attention, the mind begins to pay attention to the body and physical felt sensations and sensory perceptions. And then from that basis of paying attention to the body, the mind then begins to pay attention to the breath and all the physical sensations and impulses associated with that. So mind regulation is meditation, the mind paying attention to itself, mindfulness, which is known to have many benefits in terms of health, wellness, performance enhancement. it's meditation is a whole field, and there's a plethora of research on it. Mm-hmm. And then body regulation is the mind paying attention to the body. And of course, using the body, moving the body, paying attention to the body is a whole area of study all by itself, which is pretty obviously connected with health, well-being, wellness, performance enhancement. And then breath work is an entire field unto itself. Breath regulation is the mind paying attention to the breath, and breath work is a somewhat newer and more closer, newer at least to the mainstream Western marketplace.
Yes, yes, yes. There you go. I was going to say, it's an ancient tradition. Yogic tradition. Yeah. How many thousands year old?
in some form or another. But as a healing modality, as a practice, as a field of expertise, it's very strongly connected with health, wellness, well-being, performance enhancement, and particularly with spiritual development. All these things are also connected with spiritual development, of course, and emotional well-being, emotional clearing, emotional healing. So the three regulations, mind regulation, body regulation, breath regulation, combined together are what make Qigong so powerful, because it's a practice that combines meditation, exercise, and breath work into a single activity.
Yeah. Okay. And you actually deem that composure. I like that as like a good sum of like someone who's basically a unified person has composure. They're always composed properly.
Right. And composure. Composure, in the sense that I intend it to be used, is kind of a moment to moment thing. It's a state that you can sink into, you can fall out of, and it's really moment to moment. It's not something that you have or you don't. It's something that you're doing in this moment, or you're not. But when you're engaging all three regulations at once, that's called having composure. And I use that to have a word for the state that we cultivate. The aim of practice is to cultivate a state, and so I use the term composure. This relates to the non-exertion principle very closely, because the main drawback with overexerting is that you break your state, you lose your composure. So if you're practicing so that you can breathe fully and smoothly, then you're practicing with composure and your body is getting benefit from that practice. But if you strain too hard, you try too hard, which is the sort of thing that people often do in various situations, you might hold your breath, or you might squeeze your breath or force your breath, or you might grunt and pant, and all of these are examples of not having composure with the breath, losing track of breath regulation. For example, when people lift their legs, often people lift their leg to kick or to stretch, often they'll hold their breath, or when people turn upside down to do an inversion or a handstand or upper body inversion type movement in yoga, or just exerting generally, lifting something heavier or holding a pose that requires strength, people will hold their breath. And this is an example of trying too hard, leading to loss of composure. So when we're practicing in a range where, in a state where we're composed, then we are benefiting, we are advancing, we are progressing. If we lose composure for whatever reason, including trying too hard, pulling us out of state, then we're not getting optimum benefits from the whatever we're doing.
Okay, I love that. All right, so we have one more foundational principle. It's the six qualities. Now, these are not listed in the first section of your manual. If I can find them, I will be happy to read them out. Let's go through it and see where they show up. Nope, it's in the notes. It's not explained in the intro text. So you have to explain it to your student because it's not in the right in the beginning of the manual. So six qualities. Tell me what those are.
So there are six qualities which are outgrowths of the three regulations, and I try not to pile these on all at once at the front end because it can be kind of information overload. I like to tell people if you can count to three, you can learn Tai Chi. And this is what I say to little kids and seniors and everybody. So there's lots of threes in this system and a few sixes as well. But sorting out, learning about the three regulations, that's kind of the place to start and get a handle on the three regulations in composure, the non-exertion principle and the pleasure principle. Going more deeply into developing skills and qualities, particularly skills and qualities related to martial arts or performance enhancement in general, performance enhancement in any activity, is where the six qualities come in. So you could look at these as sort of a diagnostic tool for if you're not performing optimally, it's because one of these things is not present. If you are performing optimally, all of these things will be present. If all of these things are present, you'll be performing optimally. There are four physical qualities and two mental qualities, and these are outgrowths of the three regulations. So they're really sort of a more detailed way of describing what happens when you engage all three regulations appropriately. So the six qualities are structure, equilibrium, fluidity, body unity, sensitivity, and spontaneity. Structure, equilibrium, fluidity, body unity, sensitivity, spontaneity. Structure means that the bones of the skeleton are aligned for optimal mechanical advantage and are moving in the most efficient ways. Equilibrium is balance, means that we have central equilibrium, namely the spine is vertical suspended. We have upright balance, not where if you could be standing on one leg and leaning over and counterbalancing with your shoulders on one side and hips on the other side. And that's not what we mean by central equilibrium. Central equilibrium is the sort of classic Tai Chi posture where the lower body is sinking, the upper body is floating in whatever configuration. So it's
standing like a pole, standing like a tree, or hugging a tree. All those names are all the same thing.
I actually wouldn't compare it to a pole. A pole is the unstable equilibrium where it's balanced, but if it moves away slightly, it'll fall over. Balance more like a marble in the bottom of a bowl. Where it's balanced there, and if it moves away slightly, it
always falls back to the same.
So balance it's at a stable equilibrium as opposed to an unstable equilibrium. And then with the spine vertical, and the center over the base, all those principles from Tai Chi. So equilibrium is balance, particular type of balance.
Okay.
Structure equilibrium, fluidity means that the body moves. Well, actually, fluidity is three qualities in one. In the term fluidity, fluid has what we think of as fluid has three qualities. It has the quality of softness, smoothness, and expansiveness. So softness means the body is soft. Expansiveness means that the body is expansive and springy, not limp. There's a well developed terminology for this in Tai Chi and internal martial arts.
Yeah, I mean, a lot of our even Bruce Lee said, "Be water." So be fluid. You're always trying to just completely just, I am just water following my natural path. I lead nothing. I expect nothing. Things just happen and I flow.
Right. And this all has very deep roots in the Tao Te Ching as well, of course.
Yeah, definitely.
So, and then the third sub quality is smoothness, which means that as fluid flows, it flows smoothly. So when we're moving in a way that's smooth and continuous rather than jerky and discontinuous.
Exactly.
And just a note on terminology. I constructed this from the perspective of a modern native English speaker. So I borrowed terms minimally, basically when there's not a good term existing in English language that I can use. But when there is like softness, I'll just say softness instead of hung or shung or some Chinese word.
All the Chinese words,
Like I said, there is a very highly developed language and terminology for this in Chinese associated with Qigong and Tai Chi and traditional Chinese martial arts. And I'm writing and teaching to a primarily English-speaking audience. So as Albert Einstein said, things should be made as simple as possible and no simpler. And something that I say about martial energetics is that it borrows from, it takes roots from many ancient traditions, but it is not itself an ancient tradition. It's not a traditional style. So we're not trying to model or emulate or duplicate any traditional style. Although we certainly are incorporating their wisdom as influence. And also for the kind of idealized empty cup student, somebody who's completely new, it's not going to help them if I load them up with a bunch of Chinese terminology. It's not going to help them understand their own body any better or feel what they're feeling or pay attention to their own experience. In fact, it may very well come in the way. So as much as possible, I try to use ordinary words in the way that they're ordinarily used.
Simple terms. And you can explain it to a six-year-old, you probably are having a tough time. Explain it to a 30-year-old.
And see, these six qualities, they're English words, not Chinese terms, although there are corresponding Chinese terms for all these things. Structure, equilibrium,
fluidity, body unity.
Body unity being that the entire body works together in a cooperative fashion. When anything moves, when any part moves, the whole thing moves. And this has a lot to do with the quality of disinhibition. We muscles come in protagonist-antagonist pairs. And a lot of energy is wasted in if these are not cooperating harmoniously and smoothly, so that when the agonist activates, the antagonist deactivates, and vice versa. We tend to carry unconscious muscular tension in our body it's kind of like driving a car with the parking brake on. So
I'm an angel right now. I gotta close the blinds. Sorry. All right, that looks a lot better, and I'm not blind anymore.
So body unity is the quality of the whole body working together and cooperating. And okay. which is related to soft intent, related to the non-exertion principle. It's the state of operating with soft intent.
And we have two more, sensitivity and
spontaneity. And sensitivity and spontaneity are the more mental qualities. Sensitivity is really a synonym for awareness. And specifically awareness of the body and bodily sensations. So you can think of sensitivity or awareness as data that is coming to the availability of conscious awareness and there to be filtered and processed. The more sensitive we are, the more aware we are, the more data we are processing. And one thing in relation to the traditions of Tai Chi, every great Tai Chi master, internal master, the primary thing people say about them is they're really great masters, is usually people will not allow their strengths or their flexibility or their endurance. They'll praise their sensitivity. Oh, he was very sensitive. He's such and such master. He's very sensitive. That's what they're known for, is being very, very sensitive. And that's a quality that, well, I think one of the reasons that it's so appreciated is because it's a quality that is really, really good for your teacher to have. It really helps to learn. You can learn. The more sensitive the person you're learning from is, the faster you can learn. So it's a highly respected and appreciated quality in masters and teachers. For that reason, and also because it's one of the foundational principles of optimal performance. So it is obviously the more information available to a system of process, the more optimal and functional behaviors it can generate, actions it can produce. And then spontaneity is the quality of arising in the moment. It's similar to, related to creativity, although it doesn't necessarily have the appearance of novelty. It's probably more closely related to the quality of mindfulness.
That's what I was going to say. Like, living in the moment. That's what it sounds.
Arising in the moment, right? Spontaneity, quality that has, or action, activity that has the quality of spontaneity is activity that's arising in the moment. So, something that is unique about martial energetics is that we place a lot of emphasis on spontaneity from the beginning. And most martial arts will tell you the story that you're supposed to memorize, and then eventually be spontaneous, forget everything you've memorized. In martial energetics, we start with building it, the quality of spontaneity into our practice. So it's not some, it's, we're not erecting artificial barriers to being spontaneous. And so the core of the Qigong practice is simple patterns and postures and spontaneous movement, as opposed to long, complicated forms that you have to memorize. No, there's no memorization required. And this removes one thing that gets in the way of developing spontaneity for many people. And when they learn many martial arts or many skills in general is becoming too fixated on the strictures, and that can get in the way of developing the ability to flow freely and be freeform and spontaneous.
Oh yeah.
Of course.
Can I share something real quick?
Yeah.
As a karateka. So I did karate for years and years, and I'm getting my black belt this year, but I know for a fact they like to start, pull back. Now everyone start. Okay, go. This is our basic punch. And you teach from this position. This is how you start your techniques. So a lot of people, when they see one of those very, you know, this is how you do it, trained people.
Stylized, delineated.
Yeah, you see them at a tournament and they fight like that. They start here all the time. And it's like, this, what? You're not protecting your face. You're not protecting, I know exactly what you're going to do. there's no spontaneity about this whatsoever. You're going to punch. That's what you have. You've cocked your hand. And I can watch. I'm waiting for you to punch. And as soon as you do, I know what you're going to do and I can take it. So yeah, there is a, you start that way and you have to come out of it on your own, which is very difficult. I got lucky because one of my teachers once told me, never memorize the technique, learn the feeling and move on. Learn the feeling and move on.
Yeah. Yeah. The feeling is really fundamental. The principles generate techniques, and something that in my experience and observation, martial arts generally are very lacking in is this quality of spontaneity. And so the martial arts teachers or styles that do emphasize and build in from the beginning and teach around this quality of spontaneity are rare at this point and highly valuable for that reason. And I think that's one of the great strengths of martial energetics is that spontaneity is built into the process from the beginning. But something else that I wanted to clarify about spontaneity is that it doesn't necessarily have to be associated with novelty. We can practice simple patterns and postures and spontaneous free-form movement, but we can also do something very predictable and still be doing it in a way that is spontaneous, i.e. you can be doing a simple repetitive Qigong pattern and you can be repeating the same pattern over and over and over in a way that looks repetitive, or you could memorize a form, a long complicated Qigong sequence, and do it exactly the same way over and over and still be doing that in a way that the action is arising in the moment, that you're doing it with mindfulness. So you could memorize a form or repeat a pattern and be doing that in a spontaneous way, just as much as you could be doing completely free form movement in a spontaneous way. So spontaneity is the quality of whatever activity is happening, just being arising in the moment from within.
Okay. That was great. Okay. So we only have two more topics we want to hit today. So we have the six components in the game structure. Which you want to talk about first?
Well, I think the six components would be the natural place to go next. So we're kind of building up the framework. And from more of an intellectual adult perspective, these are the foundations, and then these are the sort of foundational philosophical principles. And okay, so now how do we train? Well, training activities are, there are basically six categories of training activities in martial energetics. And the first two are calisthenics and qi, or qigong and calisthenics. And calisthenics is actually an extension of qigong. Qigong is physical activity, solo practice, solo energy work. It's a solo practice for health, wellness, longevity. Calisthenics is a solo practice for fitness and performance enhancement. So martial energetics develops both of these areas in quite a bit of detail. And then there is the other activities are partner activities. What I call, the area that I call sharpening the weapons consists of drills, and there are essentially two types of drills, kinetic awareness and combat conditioning. The distinction isn't that important at this level of detail, but there are drills which are specific skill building activities that you can do with a partner, usually where one partner is helping the other partner to develop a specific skill. And then there are games, which are activities where two partners are doing the same thing and they're developing a skill in tandem, where they're cooperatively working to help each other improve their skill. And it's, in a way, it's kind of a blend of cooperation and competition. But fundamentally, it's a cooperative activity. They're not working to undermine or outdo each other. They're working to help each other refine their skill in a symmetric kind of way. For developing the specific martial skills in martial energetics, the two areas of qi, sao, and reaction simulation training, or RST. Qi, sao is a term, is one of those few terms that I borrowed from Chinese, because there's not a word for it in English that would make sense
properly. So,
right. And this is one of the linguistic conundrums, because qi style is a term that Wing Chun practitioners will recognize, but then when they see how I use it, they'll say, "Oh, that's not qi style. Qi style is like this and this and this."
It's
similar to the conundrum of Tai Chi people saying,
is pushing
Tai Chi, let me see, and they say, "Oh, wait, that's not Tai Chi." So specifically, qi sao is partnered energy exchange. It's a range of activities. What I actually call the proper English term for it would be kinesthetic movement arts that involve mirroring, listening, following, flowing, fundamentally, and there's lots of directions that can be taken, but most of the games, qi sao activities are mostly consist of games. And then reaction simulation training is training that is most specifically and precisely designed for self-defense. Qi sao, I should mention, is kind of a bridge. Qi sao is the bridge from qigong and tai chi to self-defense. If you're just doing qigong, and calisthenics, you'll get great wellness and fitness benefits, but you won't get any better at self-defense. Qi sao develops the qualities, the six qualities, and it develops it develops your Tai Chi skills, and it can be done in a way that it also develops martial arts skills and qualities. But reaction simulation training is specifically for self-defense. So if somebody came to learn and they're interested in learning is self-defense, and a lot of people fall into this category, they're not interested, at least at first, they're not interested in health, wellness, longevity, then reaction simulation training is where we would start. And reaction simulation training means that we're simulating as accurately as possible the physics, physiology, and psychology of violence so that we can model it accurately and appropriately so that we can safely and effectively experiment within that realm to learn how it works and how to do what we need to do. Reaction simulation training incorporates the anatomical study of weapons and targets and injury and the biomechanics of optimal strength application, optimal performance, optimal force exertion, and as well as the anatomical weaknesses and vulnerabilities of the human body. those are putting together specific skills of causing injury. And then the sixth area is play fighting, which is the most broad and inclusive kind of activity, where it's really you could look at play fighting as an activity with a set of parameters. And if you adjust the parameters a certain way, you get reaction simulation training. And if you adjust the parameters certain ways, you get the different chi sao games. There's the pushing game, the targeting game, the leverage game, the tripping game, other games. If you adjust the parameters different ways, you get these different games. But with play fighting, you just look at the whole range of parameters and adjust whatever parameters you want and play with them. It's sort of like Calvin Ball, if you remember from Calvin and Hobbes. Calvin Ball would always have they would make up the rules and change the rules as they went along.
Yeah, of course.
But specifically, it's play fighting, so it is working with incorporating the skills and qualities that are developed through Qi Sao and reaction simulation training relating to Tai Chi and self defense.
Yeah, so one of the things I like to tell my students, especially when we're dealing with push hands and RST, is there really are no rules. Like, you can make up rules all you like, and you can limit the game as much as you like, but there are no rules to what we're doing here. This is self-defense. What you do when someone's bringing violence to you is really up to you, and there are no rules that I am going to place on you if someone's coming at you with violence. If you have a gun in your pocket, well, if you think gun's necessary, then use that gun. But if you don't, then just deal with it. However you have to deal with it, there are no rules. Just deal with it. Solve the problem. And because when you bound people and you say, hey, you have to be within these acceptable parameters, well, then they can't think outside the box. So I try to make them always think outside the box, because there is no box.
Right.
That's what I kind of go for. So.
Right. Training constraints serve a valuable purpose, and they need to be used appropriately.
Yeah.
To increase or develop certain skills, but always be completely seen as completely removable and optional. And not become ingrained and habitual, and because then the space outside of those parameters sort of doesn't get picked up by our awareness.
Yeah, just one little quick example. is what you told me a while ago about the eye scratching. When a girl's, you know, when you find a woman who's dead, you find a body somewhere, a lot of times you'll find skin under the fingernails because they were scratching at the guy's face, scratching at the guy's eyes. But because they had that social training, you don't jam your thumbs into someone's face. That's just not what you do. That's not what ladylike is. That's not what a woman should do. So they didn't do it, even though if they could do this, they could have done this and they could have survived that situation. But because of whatever rules they thought they had to follow, they didn't do the thing that saved their life. And it's tragic, but it's also a teaching point, and people have to understand that.
Right, yeah. DNA evidence under the fingernails is a very, very common way that murderers are caught. And scratching is one of those instinctive things that the brain kind of resorts to if it doesn't have anything better in place, if it hasn't gone there previously in simulation in some form, then that's the sort of ineffective instinctive behavior that comes up. So I'll also talk about the game structure of martial energetics. Yes. That was the other thing you asked about. The game structure is particularly is particularly useful for presenting martial energetics to kids, where or in any group really, where the main purpose is to transmit the kinesthetic awareness and the intellectual understanding is not as important, or maybe it can be skipped, or maybe it's just, you know, their understanding, their language and understanding and attention span just aren't up to it. I say all people like that, because what I'm actually finding is adults, there are certain kind of behaviors that we associate with kids, but I notice adults do all those same things. Like, kids will talk and not pay attention when you're trying to teach them. Well, adults do the same thing, and kids. And you know, some adults are more intellectual, and some are just more shall we say physical. So
yeah, show me, don't tell me.
Yeah, there's always the range of and.
That's why we try to teach both. You explain it as quickly as you can, and then you show it as quality as you can. And it's like, this is all the details you need to see. You need to pay attention to these things. Go have fun. Go. You work with your partner now. Yeah.
The training approach always has to be adapted to the individual and or group that is present. So that's
spontaneity.
The teacher has to be spontaneous. Yeah, the very, very highly valued qualities in teachers. So basically all the kinesthetic principles in martial energetics can be taught as a series of games, which are partner exercises where you're both trying to do the same thing. And just to give a more concrete example, there are different chi sao games dealing with balance, where you and your partner are both trying to challenge each other's balance and maybe get each other a little bit off balance. But you're not trying to push each other. You're not trying to push each other over and knock each other down or shove each other. You're just trying to challenge each other's balance. You're using soft intent. You're not trying too hard. And you're giving your partner a learnable challenge. So if you find a weakness in their balance, you can give them a little bit of force there so that they can feel that weakness is there, at a level that they can sense it, they can adjust, they can adapt to it and remedy that vulnerability. And at the same time, they're challenging your balance, not so that they tip you over or knock you down, but so that they are helping you become aware of the weaknesses and vulnerabilities in your structure and equilibrium. And you're both doing this to each other at the same time. So it's a symmetric activity. It's a what would be called an infinite game, a non-directed infinite game where there's no winning, losing. It starts when you want to start, stops when you want to stop. You come together, you play for however long you want, however much you want, and then when you're done, you're done. there are partner drills that go along with that, where one person is specifically helping the other person learn, and it might be like you're giving them targets to strike, or you're helping each other feel a certain type of push, that sort of thing. But all of this can be presented kinesthetically for people, as long as they can follow directions and practice with a partner, then the kinesthetic awareness and ability can be presented in the form of a series of games. So somebody who received the system this way might not be able to explain it to somebody in great detail, but they would be able to show them adequately high fidelity.
Mm-hmm.
They'd be able to demonstrate the principles and qualities.
All right. So we are done with the main topics. I had one quick question. Well, I don't know how quick it is. So in martial energetics, you have this promotion system. You start with a student, you move to an apprentice, they become a practitioner. And once you've reached practitioner level, you say, well, you're qualified to teach at least some aspect of martial energetics. And you mentioned to me a while ago, like, oh, well, as a martial energetics practitioner, you can have specializations. So you can be a Qi Sao specialist, like an RST specialist, or a Qigong specialist. And so I'm a Tai Chi, that's my 14 years of training. And so you said, well, that makes you really strong in the Qigong and probably in the Qi Sao area. Like, you're highly sensitive, you know, the breathing techniques, you've been cultivating your energy for a long time, you know, your posture well. So you would be like a Qigong specialist. So you would teach Qigong classes better than someone who is like, I'm really good at self-defense, but I only know a little bit of the Qigong stuff. So that guy, like, taking those two practitioners, you say, well, this guy's really good at the Qigong, this guy's really good at the self-defense. So it's not like all the practitioners are necessarily the same skills. They all have the same similar sets of skills, but some are going to be heavy in one and heavy in others. So how do you, I mean, we all want to balance ourselves out. So we have good training in all three aspects, but obviously more experience breeds more specialization. So how do you go through that and classify your students and classify your apprentices? Make those kind of decisions, and how should I train this person, because this person's much more interested in this aspect than this aspect.
Well, I'll try to outline that as concisely as possible for the time that we have. There are as far as that's a good place to start is talking about the ranking, so to speak, in martial energetics. There's a pretty extensive range of skills and qualities to internalize. Mm-hmm. But it is finite. It is a self-contained system with obviously infinite potential for growth, but there's a defined core set of principles. So for somebody to benefit from this system, they don't necessarily have to learn the whole thing. So a student is just somebody who's learning some aspect of martial energetics, and a person can be a student as long as they want. And something that we don't have, and I don't foresee incorporating this. I know there are reasons that systems do, but I really don't foresee incorporating a more detailed ranking or a certification system, because if you're a student, you're doing it for the intrinsic benefits that you get. So I don't think that building in a system of extrinsic rewards is really, or progress markers, is really necessary. But the key idea is that a person can study a particular aspect of martial energetics and benefit from that. If somebody's just interested in self-defense, they could just focus on reaction simulation training, and a martial energetics practitioner would be able to teach them that and pretty exclusively. Of course, what that practitioner would say is, it's fine if you just want to study RST, but if you also study Tai Chi, RST we tend to default to calling it Sansu because it's very closely built on the training methodology of Kung Fu Sansu, which is one of the primary influences of martial energetics. So I would tell them, it's if you just want to study Sansu, that's fine, but if you study Tai Chi will improve your Sansu. And likewise, Sansu will improve your Tai Chi if you study both. But it would be possible to just focus on that and go really far with it and gain a lot of benefits. And it would certainly be very effective for self-defense training. If somebody is interested in Tai Chi, and they're just, sometimes people are interested in Tai Chi or only interested in Qigong. They're only interested in the solo practice. They say, I don't want to do any of this touchy-feely stuff. I just want to have my solo practice. And that's fine. You can just study Qigong. If you study Qigong by itself, or Qigong plus calisthenics, or just calisthenics by itself, you'll get lots of benefits.
Yeah.
And it'll be great for you. But I would recommend, if you're interested, at least try out Qi Sao. If you practice Qi Sao, it will improve your Qigong. If you practice Qigong, it will improve your Qi Sao. And likewise, there are some people who are just interested in doing push-ins and not interested in doing Qigong, and the same thing would go for them. So somebody can be a student of martial energetics for as long as they want and go on learning as much as they want about the system. If a person is interested in teaching martial energetics, then what they'll do is go through a period, a program as an apprentice instructor, which is a period where they are gaining a comprehensive understanding, both intellectual and kinesthetic grasp of the foundations, the principles, and the structure of martial energetics. So that, and the idea is not that they're going to become a master of anything. It's not that they're perfect and they're complete, but it's that their practice reaches a level of self-sustainability. Mm. They can continue to guide their own growth and development. And the comparison that I use is with the scientific community, because martial energetics is actually modeled largely on the scientific process and the way science works. If you join the community of scientists, worldwide community of scientists, you attend a university and a graduate school, and you get a degree, and that degree doesn't mean you're a master or you're perfect or you know everything. It means you're qualified to do independent research and contribute to the collective body of knowledge, according to certain standards which are generally agreed upon for how knowledge is derived. So that's what being a martial energetics practitioner means. It means that a person is able to represent the system intellectually and kinesthetically in their own unique way, but in a way that's recognizable as conveying the foundational principles and qualities and structure of martial energetics. So a person who goes through that process of being an apprentice instructor and learning how to learn so that you can learn how to teach, so that you can teach how to learn, so that you can teach how to teach.
Yep. Learning, I like that cycle. That's a good cycle.
Process all the way along. Yeah. Then that person becomes a martial energetics practitioner. And as you mentioned, as a martial energetics practitioner, you're qualified to teach any of the areas, any of the six components of martial energetics. But everyone has their own unique kind of collection of skills and qualities and you focus on different things at different times, and it's not the end of your martial arts journey. Of course, it's really just the beginning. So
every day,
right? One could go more and more into detail in any one of those areas, and the ideal martial energetics practitioner would be as balanced as possible, so they'd spend over the long term, they'd become equally developed in all of the areas, advanced equally in all the areas.
So a practitioner would be someone who is comfortable with at least Qigong, Qisao, and RST, like teaching those three specific sets of skills and all the things that go with them. If they're comfortable doing that, that's a practitioner. They got it.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, they'd be comfortable explaining it or demonstrating it.
Mm-hmm.
They'd be comfortable and confident explaining or demonstrating the skills and qualities.
All right. Well, that's all the time we have today. That was amazing. We went through a lot of stuff today. Yeah. Martial energetics, that's a system. There's a lot to it, and it takes you from zero to hero.
I like that.
But I say, yeah, if you get your balance, as soon as you get a balance, you just want to know more. That's how I got with Tai Chi. I found I wanted to learn about balance, and this is how you balance on one leg, and then I could hold it for 30 seconds. I could hold it for a minute. Oh, wow, I could hold it for 4 minutes. Oh, I held the standing posture for 5 minutes. Oh, my gosh, that's so hard to do. And you just get deeper and deeper, and then one day you're like, I did that for 45 minutes and I didn't stop and I didn't come out of my meditation. That was insane. I'd never done that before. You know, that first time you meditate for like 45 minutes straight and you don't stop, you don't flinch. That's a crazy day. I have to say that, you know, as someone who's gone through it, that's a crazy moment.
Yeah. Well, I consider myself in the business of getting people addicted to Qigong.
It's a peddler. Qigong peddler. All right, brother. Well, I gotta get going, and I imagine you do too. So
yeah, thanks a bunch. This is a lot of fun. I look forward to talking to you again soon.
All right. From San Diego, Poway, signing off. And from where were you again, Dane?
I'm in Nepal.
Kathmandu, Nepal. And what are you doing out there again?
Teaching martial arts to kids. We can talk more about that next time.
That's right. That's what I was about to get to. All right. Next time, we will continue with Tai Chi. All right. Awesome. Have a good night.
See you, brother.